Welcome to Ra Online. Today's topic is malaria in pregnancy. So malaria in pregnancy can be prevented, and we usually have three measures which are advocated by the Global Fund. So we have to use the insecticide treated nets, and they protect against malaria. The second thing promoted by the Global Fund is to get two doses of sulfadoxin pyrimethamine therapy, and if the person thinks that they are sick with malaria in pregnancy, we should go to the clinic immediately. So early treatment, prophylaxis with sulfadoxin pyrimethamine, and prevention with the help of insecticide treated nets. So these are the three modalities which has been promoted by the Global Fund. So with this lecture, we should be able to outline the causes of malaria in pregnancy. We should be able to outline the clinical features of malaria in pregnancy. We should be able to describe the maternal and fetal effects of malaria in pregnancy. We should be able to describe the maternal and fetal immunity for malaria in pregnancy, and describe the treatment of malaria in pregnancy and lactating mothers. And we should also be able to tell about the WHO package for the prevention and control of malaria during pregnancy. So the burden of disease is immense, and 2 billion people are affected worldwide. And 1 to 2.5 million deaths happen annually. And most of these pregnant women and infant of 0 to 5 years and HIV patients are the one which have got maximum deaths due to malaria. So malaria causes more death in pregnant women as compared to a non-pregnant woman. Now the problem with anti-malarial treatment is a development of resistance. And incidence of malaria has also risen in recent years because of the rise in the resistance to the anti-malarial therapy. It is caused by a protozoan belonging to Plasmodium, and the species that infect the humans are Plasmodium falciparum, Plasmodium vivax, Plasmodium ovale, and Plasmodium malariae. And the vector for malaria is the female anopheline mosquito, and occasional infections can happen with monkey malarial parasites like the Plasmodium knowlesi. Now, how do we identify a female Anopheles mosquito? So this mosquito always rests at 45 degrees. Take the axis and the posture of the mosquito, Anopheles mosquito will always be at a 90 degrees, whereas a Culex mosquito will have a flat. So how do we identify an Anopheles mosquito? So Anopheles mosquito always rests at 45 degrees from the ground. Now, Anopheles mosquito differ from other mosquitoes in their way the body is positioned. The body of the Anopheles mosquito points up in the air in one line, but the bodies of other mosquito is bent and the rear end points downwards. Now, what are the transmission levels of malaria? There are stable transmission areas, and in the stable transmission areas like Africa, they are the places where population is continuously exposed to a fairly constant rate. And during the childhood itself, a person develops immunity in a stable transmission area. And in a stable transmission areas like in Africa, the adolescents and adults are partially immune, and they may have a few parasites in their blood. But when these adults become pregnant, the immunity is reduced. And sometimes in these stable transmission areas, if the person goes out of this area, then immunity can be lost. And pregnant women and children in the areas of stable transmission have the highest risk of becoming ill. So most of these global health strategies are targeted towards the pregnant women and infants in the stable transmission areas. Now, if a person gets infected with malaria in Africa, so there can be the manifestations of disease with signs and symptoms, or the person may be asymptomatic. Now, if the disease of malaria presents with the signs and symptoms, it can be a severe disease which can lead to miscarriages, and it can lead to maternal and fetal deaths. If a pregnant woman gets an asymptomatic infection, the placental sequestration of malarial parasite happens, and the placenta integrity is altered, and this can lead to anemia because of hemolysis and maternal morbidity and death. Sometimes the baby will not get adequate nutrition, and the baby can develop low birth weight and associated with intrauterine death and growth restrictions. In unstable transmission areas outside Africa, the population is not exposed to malaria very often. So sometimes it will come only in the rainy season, and the people in unstable areas do not have immunity, and all individuals, including the children, adults and pregnant women, are all equally susceptible to malaria. In an unstable transmission area, malaria in pregnancy can be very serious and complications may occur. So a pregnant woman with malaria will have fever, clinical signs and symptoms, and sometimes severe malaria, which is life-threatening. And the malarial infection in pregnancy in an unstable area can lead to abortion, stillbirth and low birth weight. So unstable transmission areas, there are risks to the mother and risks to the baby, and all pregnancies are at risk. And the key intervention strategies as given by the WHO is to identify the disease early and do case-by-case management. Coming to the clinical features of malaria. So malaria can be uncomplicated or complicated malaria. In an uncomplicated malaria, there is usually headache, lassitude, fatigue, abdominal discomfort, muscle and joint pains. This is followed by fever, chills, vomiting and worsening malaise. If the person is infected with vivax and Plasmodium ovale, more than with the other species, they can be associated well-defined malarial paroxysmal, which include fever, spikes, chills and rigor, which occur at regular interval. So vivax and ovale have got regular interval fever and chills and rigor. In a complicated severe malaria, the patient will have fever with chills, plus there will be the presence of asexual parasitemia. And the severe or complicated malaria includes the cases of cerebral malaria, which are documented by dizziness, drowsiness, unrousable coma for at least 30 minutes. In severe or complicated malaria, we can find metabolic acidosis when the arterial pH becomes less than 7.25, or the bicarbonate level of less than 15 millimoles per liter, or a venous lactate levels of more than 15 millimoles per liter. Or we can diagnose severe malaria or complicated malaria with a hemolytic anemia, also when there is a intravascular hemolysis. It is also called as a black water fever, and the anemia in this kind of hemolytic anemias is usually normocytic, normochromic.